Are you ready to go deep? Welcome to the Whole Being Zone. Discussions on the day-to-day ways we strive to play big and be whole. Welcome to episode 121 of the Whole Being Zone. This is Wendy Reese, and today's episode is brought to you by the 2017 Desire Map Planner. These things sell out before October, and they don't even ship till November. That is how popular they are. I have been using mine since the beginning of the year, and I use it every morning to really anchor in how I want to feel for the day, focus on three things that I'm going to work on for the day, what I want to change in my life, what I am grateful for. It helps me hold accountability for the self-care that I'm committed to doing. I absolutely love it. It has really, really given me a handle on being disciplined about my self-care. So you can check it out at www.wholebeinginc.com/desiremap, and that's all one word. The link will also be in the show notes. Today, we are talking about a touchy subject. It is all about race. And my guest today is Rachel Rosen. She is an amazing woman who is taking an idea about creating deeper conversation within community on these really tough subjects and being able to embrace love and acceptance and wholeness through two projects that she's working on, Love is Love and Spark Cards for Humanity. I had a great time talking to her. She is just an amazing young woman, and I think that you will enjoy this episode too. I would love to hear at the end of it what you think about it. So definitely check into the show note page, which is going to be wholebeinginc.com/WBZ121. And leave a comment. Let us know. Let's get this conversation going. Because if not with us, then with whom? We have to be the ones who are willing to step up and start talking about the subjects that are really hard. Because if we don't, they keep being buried, and the world needs us to start shining some light and some love in these dark areas. So without further ado, here's Rachel. Welcome, Rachel.
Thank you so much. I'm so honored and happy to be here, Wendy.
So we met, time is very elusive to me lately. It seems like it's been a couple of months now when you put out a call in a mutual community that we're in to do some interviews for your Love is Love podcast.
That's right, yeah.
And I had such a great time talking to you, and I was so moved by what you were doing, and you shared a project that you have going on right now that got me pretty excited too. And I said, okay, the world needs to know about you. At least my world needs to know about you. So tell us a little bit about your podcast, and then tell us a little bit about your project.
Right on. Thank you so much. So it is a multifaceted project, actually. And it was, I also believe there's some serendipities in the world. And I think it was no coincidence that our paths crossed because I was just so struck by our conversation, and you left me really thinking differently about whole person healing, right? And so just a little background about me. I've been in education for 10 years, and I was a teacher, a school leader, and now I am a coach, an associate for an educational nonprofit. So I do leadership coaching, and I facilitate and design meetings specifically for equity. So specifically for folks to work across difference, across race, across sexual orientation. And so I, and the list goes on and on, right? When we say the across difference.
Right.
But for me, I, over the years, have just always been in inquiry mode. I've always been exploring just how it is that we, in this society, can both have all of these constraints that divide and just keep us apart, versus when there are possibilities to open up and to actually experience love and justice, there's something magical that happens. And so most recently, my project emerged this summer, truly by an accident, because all of the stars aligned and I was at a social gathering and somebody said, you know, you're positioned to actually do something about this, Rachel. You have a background, you have skills and expertise in designing, facilitating, creating these types of activities. So why don't you give it a try? And I thought, huh. And so if you rewind just a little bit, the it that they're talking about is this, the multifaceted project is called Love is Love, There is No Box. And the spirit of it is my goal is to shine light on the healing power of storytelling and the healing power of connecting across difference. And so the multifaceted nature of it is that there is a video podcast that I was launching this summer, and it's still in pilot beta test mode because that is a new area for me to explore. Yeah. And the main project that I have spent most of my energy on is this product called Cards for Humanity. And it's all about sparking conversation, sparking connection. And it's a relationship building activity for teams and for leaders. And I can tell you more about that. But those are two of the many things that have emerged as a product of doing some of this work on the side.
All right, so let's start with the video podcast, The Love is Love, because it's, I thought of you yesterday, somebody who I greatly respect and admire and have followed for many years, who is in the business of social justice, is currently doing some training with the FBI, and she happens to be in Kentucky and West Virginia, and as she was traveling from one state to the other, she was going through some very rural communities, very poor communities, and was struck by the number of Confederate flags that she saw. And her experience put her on one side of that conversation without being able to look at the totality of what those communities and what those individuals may have experienced throughout their life that led them to feeling like a proudness to fly that particular flag. And we got into an interesting conversation about, you know, and she made a derogatory comment about one of the presidential candidates. And it really made me think about where we are right now and how do we, in order to move into this place of love is love, we really do have to start having these conversations, not just with like-minded people.
Right.
So how do you, how are you doing that?
It's a great question. And I appreciate the story because I think I grew up in Texas and I know certainly there, there are Confederate flags that in certain rural counties are omnipresent, you know, they're everywhere and they are deep in the root cause of why somebody puts something up or says a particular word is, it's deeper than the surface. And it's also, I think these values and beliefs are laden with, there's some conscious thinking and then there's some subconscious, this, you know, implicit bias is real. This notion of our, what our subconscious and unconscious mind is doing. I know that you've, I've had the pleasure of listening to some of your other podcasts, and I know that you have interviewed a couple of, I think I'm trying to remember the gentleman's name who does neuroscience research. The impact of the brain. So all of that is at play, you know, and I think the only way that we can start to genuinely break down the barriers that are getting in the way of real authentic conversation and taking conversations to a deeper realm is to first have an openness to learn. I think also a really important aspect of, shifting some of the discourse right now is around being exposed to and hearing multiple perspectives and counter narratives. You know, our dominant culture is white culture, right? And so we have to first say that and name that and have a willingness to talk about race, you know, and to perhaps be a little bit uncomfortable if that makes, if that is a feeling that arises, and letting yourself sit with that, not you particularly, myself in my experience, it's like it's an ongoing journey to almost do the thing that you don't even consciously have training wheels to do yet. You know, if you're, and I'm trying to put myself in an experience of somebody in the deep South who literally has had no exposure to another way. And so they don't know what they don't know, but until they start seeing and hearing multiple perspectives, there will be no opportunity to break down those barriers. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And what do you think people need right now? And it feels like we're in quite a divisive climate, mm-hmm. particularly around race. Mm-hmm. What do you think, what tools do people need to be able to start opening their hearts and minds?
Mm-hmm. It's a great question, you know, and I don't consider myself an expert in this area by any means. I just want to say that I'm the ultimate learner in this arena. And I, I've had the privilege of working alongside some pretty phenomenal racial justice advocates and social justice advocates in my organization. The National Equity Project that I work for my day job is phenomenal. And I've had the opportunity to be trained in areas and to read up on research around implicit bias and microaggressions and white fragility, white normativity. You know, there's so much below the iceberg of just saying, it's black and white. And so I think that's the first step, is just having a moment where you realize there's a level of awareness, you know, that making some of these invisible tensions visible. And in order to do that, we must start to see and hear counter narratives. And I think there's a real example is this summer, what took place with Black Lives Matter versus All Lives Matter and the rise of Blue Lives Matter. I think it's all too easy for people to hide behind screens and to post things about X, Y, and Z without having face-to-face dialogue. And so the long answer to your question is I believe it's imperative that we have more human-to-human contact where we actually have to look in each other's eyes and hear each other's stories, listen to what's beneath the belief and the value, because it's just the metaphor of the tip of the iceberg is so real. You know, what we present with our words is just a slice of the pie of what we actually consciously and unconsciously are sitting with, you know? And so it takes sitting in structured conversations. This is why this was the impetus for my card game, really, because it's like, until people have structure or exposure, you know, I, as a teacher, you know, I had to find ways to engage my kids. Otherwise they would check out and put their heads down, you know? So I think I'm positioned to just think about, okay, what is it that, people need to have a desire. They have to see, that there will be a benefit in, breaking bread and building bridges versus ladders. Right. And I think part of that is structure. I think if you change the structure of a conversation, if people feel like they have permission, a little bit of space and an invitation to go to that deeper place and to get a little bit vulnerable, and it's actually bound by a particular experience, then I have found that there's an increased likelihood that people open up, you know? So that's one way. It's not the only way, but I've found that when in social settings and in work events, one of my dear friends just recently told me she went to a yoga retreat, and she said, you know, she looked around, she's been doing yoga for many years, and she was really happy to be in this incredibly beautiful location with about 20 other yogis. And in the evening, after they had done all of their practices, they were sitting around, it was social time, and they were talking about, they had a bunch of board games and they wanted to get to know each other a little bit better, but there wasn't exactly the structure to do so. And somebody busted out Cards Against Humanity, and everybody in the room thought, this is not, she started laughing because she said, we started to play it. And then we thought, what the heck are we doing? This is trying times right now. How could we talk about such trivial concepts? We need to go deeper. And, enough people have shared testimony like that, that caused me to just say, you know what? I'm going to take a risk, take a leap of faith and start a Kickstarter and see what happens. And so that's what happened. I ended up meeting my Kickstarter goal, and I'm moving forward in this journey of starting this product. But it's all happened. It's emerged as a result of this time that we're in right now. And there's so much division and there's so much simultaneous hunger for another way. I just keep hearing and seeing, you know, that folks are thirsty and hungry for authentic, deeper, more real conversations. But there's certainly some fear and doubt that comes to play when we think about opening up in ways that we haven't even done so, perhaps with our own families or what have you.
Yeah. So tell us a lot more about Cards for Humanity.
Yeah, I would love to. So it is the spirit of it. So it's actually called Spark because the metaphor of fire is throughout the game. I think fire across all cultures, and it goes back to ancient wisdom traditions. Fire is the symbol of community in many ways. And so I wanted to incorporate the image and the metaphor because it is certainly something that speaks to all cultures. And I find that that's very important. And so it's called Spark and then Cards for Humanity. In its initial phases, it's only 4 months old. It was born out of an experience this summer that my partner, who is African-American, and I had, we were visiting her family in LA, and we were down her brother's birthday. There was a big celebration with her family, right? So we're out, similar to the story that that I shared about my friend with the yoga retreat. We had a very similar experience where we had cake and ate and celebrated and all of these things. And then the kids went to sleep and they said, let's celebrate, you know, let's play a game. Let's play an adult game. What do we got? And they pulled out a box of games and ideas. And it's just interesting. You know, I think that perhaps somewhere inside of me, I'm like an existentialist or like a sociologist. I'm always checking. I'm fascinated by group dynamics, and I'm fascinated by the ways in which people connect. And I also have such a deep desire to have a different conversation, a depth of conversation. But I know that like a lot of people really prefer small talk, and so that's not appropriate. And so I'll float along with experiences like that. And then, you know, there's something about, we played Apples to Apples, which was great, and Cards Against Humanity, which was fine. I don't have any, this isn't a criticism of those games by any means. It was just an interesting experience because the byproduct, the indirect experience or outcome of those games is people do end up talking lightly about things that they care about. It's not the sole purpose of those games, but people start to skirt around those issues. But in my case, it was just a real missed opportunity. I looked around the room and there was such a depth of experience. I mean, Leah, my partner's grandmother, grew up in Oklahoma, and she in the 50s had incredibly trying experiences as a Black woman in America, right, in the South. And I wanted to hear her story, but there was no invitation. And it certainly isn't my place just to say, hey, Maddie, tell me about what it was like to be you when you were growing up. Fast forward, Lee and I are driving home from that party. And I said, dang, you know, that was fun. I love your family. And I'm just so sad that I didn't get to hear more about who they are and what matters most to them, especially because that particular weekend, it was right after the tragedy in Orlando. Mm. And so as I remember hearing in some of your posts this past summer, times were just really, really tough. And there was a lot of darkness and sadness in the air in June and July. And I was really struck by the fact that in all of the spaces and places that I was in, folks were struggling to approach those conversations and to feel comfortable talking about issues that were very present in the media. The only place I heard and saw it was in social media, where people had the comfort of putting a post up and then not having face-to-face conversations. And so I turned to Leah and I said, you know what? I think there needs to be a Cards for Humanity. There's gotta be something more out there. So I started researching. I looked up every which way of how another way could be possible. And there are some really great games out there, but nothing was striking the chord that I was looking for, which is combining a depth of conversation, community, sparking community and connection. And then also actually talking about justice and love and liberation in a way that I just wasn't finding, right? And when I say justice, I really just mean getting below that iceberg and allowing people to make sense of where and why their beliefs exist inside of them and outside of them. And so then Lee and I went on vacation to Mexico. We were driving down the coast, and I started brainstorming lists and lists of questions and themes. And I thought, okay, it'll be just like Cards Against Humanity, but it'll be flipped. It'll be reversed. So the goal will be to spark a different conversation. And so now 4 months later, I have done 3 beta test prototypes, and I've had multiple folks provide feedback and have influenced the direction of the game, and I'm so grateful for that. And it's still emerging as we speak. I'm starting a business class on the side and pushing this to. And the goal is to have more access. I want more people to access structures and experiences that they desire if they need them, right? And I just haven't found enough ways for this challenge to be resolved. So that's a lot, but in a nutshell, it's a game for people who want to spark meaningful conversations and connections, and who, there are two kind of audiences that I've found are most compelled and intrigued by this, which is really visionary leaders, you know, whether they're business leaders or community leaders who are committed to their team's growth and believe that meaningful connections have a lasting and powerful impact. So those are the types of leaders that I've had the privilege of working with in schools and in organizations, who really invest time in getting to know their people, you know, facilitating retreats and community building activities, because they see that their staff, their employees are more than just a number. They see them as human beings that they want to understand so that they can ultimately feel seen, heard, and produce quality work, right? Because there's a ton of research about efficacy and sustainability with regards to when staff and employees feel that they're really seen and heard and they're grounded in their why. So that the first bracket is for leaders. And then the other one is just for, it's a social fun relationship building activity for communities, families who just are similar to me, not all about small talk. And they want to enjoy real, honest, authentic conversations and to strengthen their bonds so that they can walk away with another way of thinking. You know, the thing about fire is that once you light a match, you can't get it back. You can't ever go back to its original form. And the fire is lit, and there's an experience. And then you actually walk away with whether it's a slight or a large transformation that happens with fire. And that's my real goal, is to have storytelling be the vehicle for some healing.
Nice. Well, I want to kind of go back to Grandma Maddie for a minute, because one of the things that really, when we spoke, was heavy on my heart, because I grew up in Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. And I remember seeing these signs in certain rural communities, and I know these are in Texas too, mm-hmm. that say, "Inward, don't let the sun set on you," mm-hmm. in this town. And having a great-grandfather who was in the KKK, and growing up in a prejudiced environment, and having to really find my way out of that, and still finding some of those threads within me, and wondering, how do I have this conversation, where if I do have the conversation, because there's somebody in social media that I did try to engage with who wanted to have those conversations, but the way that they went about it, there was just so much shame and guilt.
Right.
Applied into it that I thought, I can't have this conversation, because it's hard enough to even say, hey, I'm sorry for who my family is. Right. And I'm sorry for what I picked up from them. And I want to help build these bridges and break bread. But as long as I'm getting the guilt and shame dumped on me, I'm going to put my defenses up, and I can't have that conversation with you. Mm-hmm. So I was really intrigued by what you are doing. And right around the same time that we talked, mm-hmm. right after Orlando, my walking partners are both quite a bit older than me. And they knew that they're closer to my father's age, and they know that my dad is gay. Mm-hmm. And they, one of them towards the end of our walk, and she knew something wasn't right about me. I was feeling pretty heavy that next morning. Mm-hmm. And she said, I'm really sorry about what happened. That must be really hard for you.
Hmm.
And I, it took me back because I knew that where she came from, that was not an easy thing for her to say.
Hmm.
And to be able to even start to engage that conversation, they shut down pretty quick.
Mm-hmm.
But they tried. And I thought, if we can have more opportunities like this where we can try.
Right.
The conversation and to have the tools to not shut down and to not close off when it starts getting really uncomfortable because we don't know, we're not familiar. And,
right.
And I was psyched to hear about your game and I will, you know, in transparency, I am a backer of it because I do. Mm-hmm. It. And so, and very, very excited to be able to get my copy so that I can integrate them into my business, because I think it is so critical right now that we are having these conversations. And even we talked on the podcast that I was with you, but I want to bring it up here because I think it's important for the audience to hear.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about sexuality and we talked about how do we move to a place where we can be more open and not have to be so confined to what society expects of us. And I think you touched on this a few moments ago when you talked about why do we believe what we believe? And I remember in a philosophy class, the teacher on the very first day said, what are your basic beliefs? And I was like, oh yeah, that's easy. It took me 2 freaking years to answer that question.
Mm-hmm.
2 mm-hmm. years, because I had to unweave what was mine and what's everybody else's and why do I believe it? So I'm curious, how do you think your cards and how do you think the work that you do in your day job help people unravel that belief system and to really start to explore it?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Absolutely. So I want to first say, I meant to say this at the very beginning, I'm so grateful and humbled that you chose to back my project. Really, Wendy, I know I sent you a message, but I wanted to just say that out loud, that I'm so grateful. And it means the world to me. And I think this is just one offering, you know, it's one vehicle, it's one way to think a little bit differently, in the hopes that people are, something is sparked inside of others, you know, and it's not the only way. You know, I have have big dreams and big ideas around how it's going to look to really have entry points for all walks of life, because it's not just one way. You know, the card game isn't going to work for everybody. And I know I'm okay with that. Some people it's going to be videos, other people it's going to be maybe face-to-face community gatherings, other people it's going to be online applications. You know, I believe that there is not a one size fits all model when we're talking about all walks of life. I can speak from my experience, some of the most formative as a white woman in this world who has been grappling with and doing my own inside out work for the past 10 years since I started working in education by accident, right? I didn't, when I entered the teaching profession, I didn't know I was signing up for inside out racial healing. I had no idea right. that's what I was signing up for. But when you're working across difference, when you're teaching young people who have different cultural values, beliefs, and racial identities, I felt, this is my experience, that it was my responsibility to check my own assumptions and to think about, what is my ego talking? What is my own pride saying? And then what is it going to look like for me to distance myself from those things? And so for me, some of the most helpful ways, I mean, speaking to your example of it's hard work. And sometimes it's so deep in the unconscious that we don't even know how and where these values and beliefs are coming from. And so I don't know if you've heard, there's a lot of research that I can provide afterward, but Peggy McIntosh is one of the biggest names in the realm of privilege. And since you mentioned the word privilege, I just want to, especially when we talk about white privilege, and she talks about it as an invisible backpack. that that folks wear. And so she started doing this a long time ago, and now she's in her either late 70s or 80s, and she's an incredibly just brilliant woman who's informed a lot of the research out there on whiteness and privilege and advantage and disadvantage. And what she's opened my eyes to is the fact that, or what she did when I first read, she has an article about her making the unconscious conscious. And literally she asked herself, and I'm paraphrasing here, but it's something around the lines of, what are my privileges and how does that impact me? And she literally couldn't, she couldn't list them. She struggled, and she found, she felt like she was a fairly self-aware person. And this is early in her career. She took out a notepad and she thought, huh, what are the privileges that I have that advantage me as compared to my peers who are people of color? And she couldn't, she actually couldn't list, she couldn't think of them. And so her journey was, she put a notepad next to her bedside table and committed to for 30 days, I believe, and maybe so, somewhat like lightly under or over, I can't remember. I'll look it back up. But basically, she put a notepad next to her bedside table. And what happened over the course of those, that month, was her unconscious mind lifted up the stories of her privileges and the ways that she has advantages that she didn't earn, but just by nature of how she was born into the world, she had them. Things like she would have a dream about, okay, so I have access to curriculum. When I look at any book in the bookshelf of my child or in my classroom, most of the people look like me. I don't have to worry about the names not representing my culture. I don't have to think about the color of their skin not representing me. And that's one of those nuanced kind of subtleties, right? That she realized it emerged in her dream. And there's so many more I could tell you more about at another point. But that's just to bring to the surface that it is nuanced work. It's not just, and this is my mantra, is that there are no binaries, are so divisive when we're talking about social justice, when we're talking about racial justice. I think binaries are really not helpful in the conversation of privilege versus not privilege, advantage versus not disadvantage, like ranking ourselves as being more privileged or less privileged. I have found when we're trying to really build bridges and heal and be in community together, I found that it's not super helpful to say, well, you're more privileged than I am, so you have all these advantages and disadvantages. It's about, for me, the inside out work. I keep using that language because it really is, people have to hold up the mirror and do some inside reflecting and healing about how living in the system of oppression that we live in, it is a system that by design advantages some people and disadvantages others, depending on where they're positioned relative to opportunity, right? And so
absolutely,
it's just, it's more nuanced than just like white, it's white and black, or you have privilege or you don't. I mean, we all walk through the world with advantages that we have unearned just by nature of who we are and how we were born into the world and the geography of where we were born into the world. All of that is plays a part. And so, so much of my work with leaders, it is in service, this inside out work is in service of leading and walking a way that allows staff, allows young people to be fully seen. And when you have a level of distance from your ego and connection to your soul and yourself and who you are and your values and beliefs and how they inform how you show up for your people, then you are experienced with as someone with more grace and more understanding and more consciousness. And that is what we need when we're talking about children who deserve and are worthy of educators who are operating from a place of openness and compassion. And if because we all have implicit bias, it's acknowledging and accepting who we are and not being ashamed of who we are, but working through it and then thinking about, okay, how does that impact me? And how do I need to show up for you so that you can be your best self? So that I, you know, when I work with educators, it comes down to tone of voice or proximity. I mean, there's just so many cultural nuances that I think come to play that sometimes we overlook that actually have a tremendous impact on human to human experiences.
You just said so much.
Sorry.
Girl, we could spend days unpacking that. And I, mm-hmm. you know, you're touching on my deep, deep passion and mm-hmm. soapbox around education and around the inequalities within it. Mm-hmm. I can remember working in a particular community in Phoenix in grad school. And the elementary school in this community, because it was a predominantly Hispanic community, that there would be several siblings who had shared the same teacher. Well, by the time sibling number two or three came through, they were lumped into whatever behavior patterns the first three or more had. Right. And they were so overworked, so underpaid, mm-hmm. that they didn't have, and it's not their job to be the social worker, but there's no looking deeper into, well, why are these behavior patterns happening?
Right.
And what's the root cause? Yeah. And I think when we have these conversations about race, mm-hmm. and we've had these conversations quite a bit, it's not just about whose life matters. And it's not just about, well, we need to train the police not to kill unarmed people. Yeah, great. That's fabulous. But we're not talking about the other components to that of, well, what is the cultural and the environment that create the setup that we're in right now? And how do we, it is so, to me, when I start pulling that string of that tangled up ball of yarn, mm-hmm. it can really get overwhelming. So mm-hmm. how do you, as somebody who is in it day in and day out, mm-hmm. how do you keep yourself grounded? How do you mm-hmm. keep yourself from going into that place of overload and overwhelm and paralysis that so often happens when we get to that point?
That's a really good point. And that's why I think it speaks to your larger mission of this whole human, this whole being experience, because self-care is very important. And there are residual effects of living in this oppressive system. And they oftentimes manifest physically, they manifest emotionally, they manifest in all sorts of ways if we don't tend to them, right? And so I have all sorts of practices that I work on. I'm not perfect by any means, and I'm just the ultimate, truly work in progress. Like I end each day thinking, okay, I did as best as I could today. There's more I can do. And nice. I did my best today. And I do breathing exercises. I exercise with yoga or hiking or walking. I spend time in nature. I journal. I have to release with my body and with my mind so that my spirit can thrive. Because I found that if all three, body, spirit, mind, are not having some outlet, some way to be tended to and to live in harmony with one another, then I get impacted in negative ways, you know, and I've certainly gone through phases where it's like my mind gets more attention and my body doesn't. And so it starts speaking to me after a couple weeks or, you know,
yeah.
But I do know that this work is not for the faint of heart. It is an incremental process. And I think that's why who you choose to be around is so important. I don't actually, you know, so much of my life I lived as a people pleaser, and that took me down a path of literally my body shutting down. I was, prior to being in this relationship, I was actually in a heterosexual relationship. I was married, I got divorced. And I have a lot of, I have done a lot of healing and have gone through quite a bit of ups and downs emotionally from that experience. And the reason I bring it up is because enough was enough. One day my body just said, you cannot live this life for other people anymore. And I think that sometimes as women, we tend to take on so much, right? Women are leaders, are warriors, are holders, are keepers, are lovers, are mothers. And if my example of being a strong woman was taking care of everyone around me before I took care of myself, then I actually internalized that message so deeply that I forgot who I was. And so by stepping out of that that complete comfort zone of people pleasing and screaming, this is who I am, metaphorically. You know, I had to leave this marriage and I was so unhappy, and I chose myself in the ultimate way possible, and every way possible. I received judgment, and my worst fears were realized at that moment in my life. But what I didn't realize was it was the absolute best thing I could have done, because I was able to weed out all the people who judged me and looked at me differently and made assumptions about who I was. I didn't actually need that energy in my life anyway. And I had lived 29 years in my head thinking that that was the comfortable way of living. And so I say all that to say, you know, once I chose me and then love came to me, real love, a real partnership, I realized sexuality is such, there's such a spectrum, and I don't openly identify as a lesbian because I think that there's so much more underneath that iceberg, and I could go on and on about that. But what has been the byproduct of that experience of just coming out for love is people either unfriending me or not talking directly to me about my choices, or people talking directly about them and me realizing, this is worth the investment and the time, and I'm going to stay in this conversation because I love you and care about you. Or this is the energy that I don't need in my life. I need to be around people who are on the same, who are on the same journey with me, and who are fighting for a larger reason, who want genuine, authentic love in this world, and who accept and embrace all walks of life. And so if you're going to judge me and write me off because I don't fit into the box that you think I should, that's okay. I don't need your energy in my life anymore, you know? And so this whole notion of there is no box, race is a social construct. And the moment that somebody can see, being colorblind is absolutely dangerous. I think it's very, very harmful when I hear people say, I'm colorblind, I don't see color, because I find that that is actually a way of covering up some racist tendencies or values and beliefs that have been internalized, right? If you don't see color, then you can't see racism, and therefore you're reproducing some discourse or actions that are probably harming some way, advertently or inadvertently, right? And so the reason I bring all of that up is because until, for my own self as a white person, until I could see my students, my coworkers who were people of color, if I could see them as family and I internalized their experience as my own, I wasn't going to put myself out on the limb to fight on the front lines and to post something that's provocative, to get vulnerable publicly. Like, I didn't have any exposure to that. I didn't have any understanding. I didn't have a schema for what it looked like to be vulnerable and in solidarity and in a community who supports you and loves you and who will not judge you if you stumble. And so the only way I get through this is to have a community of support, to have people around me who also value self-care, community care, and who walk this journey of justice and love.
Well, I think the saying that you are an example of the five people you were closest with, I don't know who your five people are, but they are magnificent. So thank you for surrounding yourself with people who are helping you to step more and more into you. You are a light in a world that, whose light has dimmed a little bit this year. But, you know, and I think I can't remember if we talked about that. I've talked about this part to so many people. Mm-hmm. As much as I disagree with him and his philosophy and what he is stirring up, I am grateful for Donald Trump coming into the light in the way that he has, because it's made us start talking about something that so few people were willing to talk about for so very long. Mm-hmm. And to say that, oh, well, we don't still have racial inequality in the United States. Civil rights is done. It's so much has changed. And that's true. You can go into an airport and you'll have 50 different cultures sitting around you. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't mean that what is in people's belief systems have changed. Right. And I think that the light dimming has allowed us to really start an exploration that is long overdue. So thank you for being on that front line, and thank you for doing everything that you're doing. I'm really proud and honored to be a part of your world now, and you being a part of mine, and thank you for that.
Thank you so much. I'm truly humbled, and it takes people like you bringing these conversations up to the forefront of other folks' radars to make this conversation possible. So I'm really grateful to have had the opportunity to be here. And I think if there's anything that I were to leave your listeners with, it's to approach this world with a curiosity that is unlike anything else. You know, what could be possible? You know, I have tools and resources, and as a part of the game, when it comes out, there'll be more on my website at the start of 2017 as ways for people who want to take conversations to a deeper realm. It's not about a game to me. This is just one activity that's an olive branch, right? It's a one way to enter into this conversation. But to me, sparking conversations, sparking connections, it's about a lifestyle, and it's a lifestyle of openness. It's a lifestyle of curiosity and a willingness to listen, to truly listen and to lean in before making assumptions about other people's walks of life and other people's experiences. I mean, how different would the world be if we all just took a pause before making an assumption when we're talking about people across difference? And so continue to surround yourselves with folks who push your thinking a little bit. And you know, I think this is how for centuries we have survived, is by staying curious, by being in community together, by circling up, by restoring harm, by not giving up, by not getting defensive, but by turning to one another too and saying, I need help. Can you help to think through this with me, because I'm human and I'm stuck and that's okay, you know? And so know that I'm here, and I am honored to be a part of this journey with you.
And how can people find you?
Yeah, thank you. So I have a website right now. It's all in construction, but it's right now, it's in a place where it's all good. And at the beginning of 2017, there'll be a whole new rehaul, but it's loveislove.site, S-I-T-E. And also cardsforhumanity.site. They take you to the same place. So if one is easier to remember, then great. And then loveislove.thereisnobox@gmail.com. And that will come directly to me. I'm so eager and open and excited to hear feedback and ideas of your listeners around what Cards for Humanity could look like. As a feature of the game, there will be an open dialogue for people to actually suggest cards to be included in the game. Yes. And because I'm so honored and grateful to be here, I will say that in November, any of your listeners, if they want to join my Facebook group, I'll be offering a free downloadable PDF. In November, once they get on the Facebook group, which is, there's a link to that on my website. It's my holiday surprise and exclusive giveaway for December. Nice. So when they come on, if they come on the Facebook group, then there'll be a downloadable PDF at the end of November, at the beginning of December, just as a way of saying, hey, thank you. And by 2017, the first manufactured and produced decks of cards will be in coffee shops and bookstores, hopefully across the country. So if you're a listener and you have a space, a community gathering venue, and you're interested in pre-ordering a deck of cards, I would be so honored. Definitely reach out to me and we'll be in touch.
Perfect. And one last question. What does whole being mean to you?
Great question. I think it just comes back to my point earlier about the mind, body, and spirit really being in sync. And I am a musician as well. And so I hear a song where mind, body, and spirit are singing and working together in harmony. And so I would say that's my answer.
That's beautiful. Thank you so much, Rachel. It has been an absolute pleasure.
Oh, likewise, Wendy. Thank you so much.
All right. I hope you enjoyed the show. And please go check out the show notes page, wholebeinginc.com/WBZ121. Check out the Desire Map Planner and infinite love and gratitude. Start having those conversations. And until next time, be whole.